to lift up the name of the Lord this morning. Again, I greet each of you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. So good to see all of you in the house this morning. So great to see all of you worshiping with us online. We greet you in Jesus' name. We welcome you to Spirit Anew Ministries. I'm going to ask if you would stand as we consider our morning passage, our worship passage for the morning as we open our celebration today. This is a great day. Join me in going to the book of Isaiah. We're going to look at chapter 12. The prophet Isaiah offers up a hymn of praise. It's a wonderful praise. And there in the 12th chapter, we're going to consider verses 1 through 6. Isaiah the prophet, as he recognizes the very glory of God, the majesty of God, he makes this declaration. He says in verse 1, "In that day you will say, I will praise you, Lord. Although you were angry with me, your anger has turned away, and you have comforted me. Surely, God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid." Now, the choir just sang about that this morning. In God, we will put our trust. He goes on to say, the Lord himself is my strength and my defense. He has become my salvation. With joy, you will draw water from the wells of salvation. In that day you will say, give praise to the Lord, proclaim his name, make known among the nations what he has done, and proclaim that his name is exalted. Sing to the Lord, for he has done glorious things. Let this be known to all the world. Shout aloud and sing for joy, people of Zion. For great is the Holy One of Israel among you. Give God some praise. He is worthy. Great and wondrous is his name this morning. Let us look to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for every gift, every blessing, every kindness and courtesy that you extend on our behalf. Lord, we just want to say thank you. Lord, thank you for this day that you've given us. Thank you for this opportunity to gather together in worship and in celebration of our awesome and powerful God. Father, we pray that your spirit would rest with us this morning. Allow us to worship you in a way that honors you and pleases you. May our praise rise up to you as a sweet-smelling savior to your nostrils and a pleasant sound unto thine ears. Lord, bless us this morning in all that we do, that you may be glorified and we, your people, may be edified. For that, Father, we thank you, we love you, and we praise you. And it's this prayer that we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. God bless you. Turn to your brother. Turn to your sister. Greet them in Jesus' name. To all of our guests, we welcome you here this morning. We thank you so much for taking the time out to visit us here at Spirit Anew Ministries. We celebrate you being with us this morning. Again, to everybody worshiping online with us, we thank you for joining us here at Spirit Anew Ministries this morning. This is the great day that the Lord has made, and we are here to rejoice and be glad in this wonderful day. You may be seated. I have just a couple of real brief announcements I want to bring to your attention. Today, we are celebrating our veterans. We know that Veterans Day is coming up this weekend, but we are getting a jump on it, and we want to celebrate all of our veterans in the house this morning. And we thank God for the sacrifices that they've made in order to secure our freedom and to protect us here in these United States. And so, all of our veterans in the house, I'm going to ask if you would just stand. We want to acknowledge you. We want to celebrate you. We want to let you know how glad we are. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. To each of our veterans, on behalf of a very grateful country and a grateful nation, we thank you for all of your efforts, all of your sacrifices for you and your families. And we want to let you know how grateful we are for all that you have done, all that you're doing, and all of our service personnel here locally, domestically, and abroad. We want you to know that we thank God for all that you are doing, and we praise God for you. May God continue to bless you. May God keep you, and may God continue to bless your families as well. Once again, thank you so much. God bless you. God bless you. I also want to extend a couple of thank yous. We want to acknowledge a card that we received from the family of Pastor Terry Jones and his family, the White family and the Miller family, as they did a memorial celebration this past week for Tony White. And the card says, thank you. Kindness is a small gesture that makes a big difference. With sincere gratitude and warmest thanks, the Jones, the White, and the Miller family. So we just want to let you know that we are praying for you in light of your loss and that we are continuing to keep you and your family in our sincere prayers. Also, for any others who may have lost loved ones this week, we want you to know that we are praying for you just as well. We are also praying for all of our homebound, those who were not able to come out. And we're going to take a moment and we're going to lift them up in prayer in just a moment. But I do want to also acknowledge a thank you from Mother and I and from all of our clergy. You celebrated us last week, and we thank God for your kindness, for your compassion, and for your sensitivity to the work of the ministry. I want to read a card from Mother and I, and this is to each of you, our spirit, a new family. We just want to thank you so very much for the gifts that were rendered unto us on last Sunday in our Clergy Appreciation Day. Your thoughtfulness is greatly appreciated. We both are very thrilled and humbled by your kindness in the reception of the cell phone, the flowers, the gift card, all of your love and all of your prayers. We want to thank you so very, very much. It is a wonderful thing to be appreciated, and it's also wonderful to give appreciation to others. So this note is just a way of us letting you know that we thank God for us being able to come together, and we appreciate all of your prayers and all of your supports as we've come together to change lives, meet needs, and to establish a spiritual community that people might come to know God through Christ Jesus. We thank you, we praise God for you, and again, we love you and thank you so very, very much. God bless you. I also want to mention that immediately following our worship service this morning, we have an announcement coming from our finance department. So I'm going to ask if everybody who are members of Spirit of New, if you would stay for just a couple of moments. It's going to be a very brief announcement regarding our finance ministry, some information that needs to be shared with each and every one of you. Also, remember that this coming Tuesday is Election Day. So please make sure that you get out to the polls. Make sure that you cast your vote for your candidate. We as Christians, we ought to be involved in that process. Yeah. We need to help set the tone and express our need for our representatives who are going to be representing us in these different offices. So please make sure, if you know somebody who's having some difficulty getting to the polls, please swing by, pick them up, get them out, make sure that we get as much representation at the polls as we possibly can. Also, to remember to keep Israel in our prayers. You know, Israel, they're God's people, and so we need to continue to lift that nation up in prayer as they're going through an extremely difficult time. We want to lift up all of those who are casualties of war, whether it's the war going on in Ukraine, the one in Israel. So many people are dealing with tragedy and loss, and so we as the household of faith want to remember those in our prayers. Also, I do want to mention that this coming Wednesday, we are not going to have our Bible study. We're going to resume next Wednesday, so I just want to make that note. And please also take note of the announcements that are in your bulletin.
because there's so many other announcements there that I'm not going to go over, but you can look at those just so that you can see the dates of those things that are upcoming so you can govern yourselves accordingly. Also, let's take this time to just celebrate our God. You know what? All of us are blessed today. We made it to the month of November. We are in the 11th month of this year. There was no guarantee when we saw January of this year that we were going to make it to month 11. And so we ought to give God a praise just for seeing us and keeping us and allowing us to see 11 months this year. All right, we're going to take a moment to look to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, once again, we come and we thank you for all of those gifts and blessings and kindnesses that you extend to us. Father, we come specifically on behalf of those who were not able to make it out to worship, those who were going through difficult seasons in their lives right now. They're having some challenges that are just hard for them to deal with. So, Father, we're praying that you would bless them, strengthen them, encourage them, allow them to know that you're an all-loving and all-gracious God. Help them to know that you are the God of compassion, the God of caring. And so, Father, continue to minister to their needs. Lord, we pray for those who've lost loved ones recently, and we ask that you would love on them, minister to them, fill the void that they are filling right now, and allow them to know that you are the God who is always right there. You are the God who we can reach out to. We can lay our head upon your breast, and we can find peace and rest in you. Father, we thank you for this opportunity to intercede on behalf of those who are in need. And we ask that you would minister in such a way that they would be edified and you would be glorified. For these things, Father, we love you, we praise you, and we offer our thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Again, God bless you and thank each of you for your prayers. Saints, it's time that we worship God through the giving of our gifts, our tithes, our offerings, our sacrificial giving, and we do this, number one, just to glorify God, because God continues to bless us each and every day. So we give to God as a form of celebration and appreciation for what God continues to do. But we do it also out of obedience. The Bible tells us, let us bring our tithes to the storehouse, that there would be meat in mine house herewith, saith the Lord of hosts. And so if you'd like to contribute and give to Spirit and New Ministries, you can do it several ways. If you're here in the house, immediately following the worship, you can deposit your tithes and offerings in our tithe box. If you'd like to give by mail, you can mail your offerings here, your tithes, to Spirit of New Ministries, 1634 Rangeland Road, Louisville, Kentucky, 40219. And we are certainly thankful for that way of giving. We also, if you would like to give online, you can do that by going to Givelify. And there you can look for Spirit of New Ministries and follow the prompts for your giving. You can also go to our website, which is spiritofnewministries.com. And there on the front page, you can click on the donations tab. There you can follow the prompts for your giving. And we've added a new way. You can now give through Zelle. And at Zelle, if you like to give that way, you can go to samfinance@mw.twcbc.com. I'll say that again. That's samfinance@mw.twcbc.com. And any way that you give the Spirit of New, we are so very thankful and we appreciate you supporting us as we continue to do the ministry that will help bring people to the knowledge of Jesus Christ. Let's look to the Lord once again in prayer. Dear Lord, we again come before you as we render our gifts, our tithes, the portion of what you've given us, Lord, we render back unto thee. All we ask, Lord, is that we be used for kingdom purpose and that all of your purposes would be accomplished. Allow us to do what's pleasing in your sight on a continuous basis that others might come to know Jesus Christ. Help us to minister to the needs of this community. And for that, Father, we offer our thanks. It's this prayer that we do ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. And again, God bless each and every one of you. It's time, saints, for the word. So those of you who can and will, if you would stand as we consider God's word together. If you have a Bible, please feel free to open your Bibles. If you have a device, please set it to the book of Exodus. And in Exodus, we're going to the 34th chapter of Exodus. There in Exodus 34, we're going to consider verses 1 through 8, and I will be reading from the English Standard Version. Exodus chapter 34, beginning at verse 1 through verse 8. And there it reads, "The Lord said to Moses, 'Cut for yourself two tablets of stone like the first, and I will write on the tablets the words that were on the first tablets, which you broke. Be ready by morning, and come up in the morning to Mount Sinai, and present yourself there to me on the top of the mountain. No one shall come up with you, and let no one be seen throughout all the mountain. Let no flocks or herds graze opposite that mountain.'" So Moses cut two tablets of stone like the first, and he rose early in the morning and went up on Mount Sinai, as the Lord had commanded him, and took in his hands two tablets of stone. The Lord descended in the cloud and stood with him there, and proclaimed the name of the Lord. The Lord passed before him and proclaimed, "The Lord, the Lord, a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness, keeping steadfast love for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, but who will by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children and the children's children to the third and fourth generation.'" And Moses quickly bowed his head toward the earth and worshiped. You may be seated. This is a familiar phrase for so many people, but this morning I want to encourage you with the thought, what a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. When I think about the essence and the sheer gravity of this passage of scripture, I'm just going to be honest with you. I can't help but to be in utter amazement and in deep humility, because it causes me to think of the redemptive nature, the compassionate nature, the forgiving nature of our God. The Bible is replete, it's full of examples of how God extended his kindness, his forgiveness, and his grace. And he did so on the heels of grievous sins committed by the very people that he loved and provided for. God was gracious. God was compassionate. And in his compassion, this God, who time and time and time again rescues and provides for his people, it's this same God who withholds his punishment, the punishment that they no doubt deserved, a punishment that he could have exacted upon them. This punishment that God could have said, "Because you have grievously sinned against me, I will unleash my wrath." But God in his grace withheld himself, kept himself from releasing his punishment. And just as he did that then, he still does that now. So we are all of people most blessed. And the Bible shows us time and time again how God did that, how God, out of his mercy, out of his grace, withheld his anger, withheld his judgment to a people who were so deserving. You know, David, the psalm writer, made a couple of mentions when he said in Psalm 86, he said, "But you, Lord, are a compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness." Once again, in the 103rd Psalm, he kind of repeats it. He says, "The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love. He will not always accuse, nor will he harbor his anger forever." He said he does not treat us as our sins deserve, nor does he repay us according to our iniquity. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. You may not realize it, but God is gracious. He is ever compassionate. And then Moses went on to declare in Numbers 14, he says, "The Lord is slow to anger, abounding in love, and forgiving sin and rebellion. Yet he does not leave the guilty unpunished. Punishes the children for sin of the parents to the third and fourth generations." And then the prophet Nahum, he says in his first chapter, "The Lord is slow to anger, but great in power. The Lord will not leave the guilty unpunished. His way is in the whirlwind and the storm and the clouds and the dust of his feet." And then when we skip into the New Testament, the Apostle Peter, he says in his second installment in the third chapter, he says, "The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some consider slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance." God is gracious. He is merciful in all his ways. And so as we consider our passage for the morning, we look to the beginning of the Bible in this 34th chapter of the book of Exodus. What we see here is our loving, our gracious, and patient God. He once again extends his mercy to a sinful Israel. But to better understand why God is utilizing Moses in this 32nd or 34th chapter, it's necessary for us to kind of back up a little bit, to go into the 32nd chapter to see what provoked the very ire of God and of Moses in the first place. When we look at Exodus chapter 32 and we consider verse 15. Note what it says there. It says, "Then Moses, he turned and went down the mountain with the two tablets of the testimony in his hand." Tablets that were written on both sides, on the front and on the back, were they written. The tablets, verse 16, were the work of God. And the writing was the writing of God engraved on the tablets. When Joshua heard the noise of the people as they shouted, he said to Moses, "There is a noise of war in the camp." But then verse 18 reveals, "But he said, it is not the sound of shouting for victory or the sound of the cry of defeat, but the sound of singing that I hear." And then verse 19, he says, "As soon as he came near the camp, saw the calf and the dancing, Moses' anger burned hot, and he threw the tablets out of his hand and broke them in front of the mountain." Moses was angry. God was angry. And
Moses, out of his anger, his ire, his frustration, his detestment of the fact that these people, while he was gone for just a little while, decided that we don't know what happened to Moses. He's been gone for a while, so we need to create our own God because Moses is no longer around. We can't find him. We don't know what he's doing. We don't know what God did to him. So we need to kind of make some arrangements that will allow us to create a God that we can worship. And so they got with Aaron. And they got in his ear and they started snatching all of the jewelry off their neck and from around their body. And they threw it in the fire and they made this golden calf. And so now they're celebrating and dancing and they're in their lewdness and doing things that were not pleasing unto the Lord. And so as God was up on the mountain, as Moses was with him, and as God was giving him the commandments, God looked down and said, you need to get back down there. Those folk are out of order, and you need to deal with that. And so now as Moses, as we see here in chapter 32, Moses now makes his way back down the mountain. He's carrying the stones of the tablet that were written on front and on the back that God had etched his commandments. And as he's coming down the mountain, he's hearing a sound, and Joshua, his aide, his servant, was saying, well, it sounds like the sound of war. They must have gone out and they must have conquered, and so there's a celebration going on. And Moses said, no, that's not the sound of war. That's the sound of singing. There's some celebration going on, and it's not because God has extended his power in order that they would be victorious in war. He said, no, that's not what it's about. It's about something else is going on. There's something savory that's happening here, and so we need to go on and do that. And it says, as soon as he got to the camp, he saw the calf. And if you remember, when Moses addressed his brother Aaron about this calf, you remember what he said? He said, well, what is all of this? What's going on here? And Aaron says to Moses, well, the people said we need to do this and we need to celebrate. And we didn't know what was going on with you. You were gone for so long. You're our leader, but we didn't see you. We didn't know where you were. You didn't leave a forwarding number for us. We couldn't reach out to you. And so we needed to do something. And so we threw all of this gold into the fire and out popped this calf. And if you read the text, that's just what it, out popped this calf. You see how people, when they're out of order and want to shift the blame and not take responsibility, oh, the calf just kind of popped out. Moses was angry. And Moses was, in essence, reflecting the very sentiments of God. Because God had been good to Israel. God had blessed them in the midst of their captivity to the Babylonians. Or not to the Babylonians, but to the Egyptians. The Babylonian captivity would come down the road, but God had allowed them to come out of this Egyptian captivity, allowed them to come through the waters, allowed them to come across the plains of Moab. And so here, God has been good to them, had been blessing them. But they decide that the God who had brought them out of captivity, the God who had seen them across the plains, was no longer worthy of worship. And so as Moses comes down the mountain, he sees them worshiping false gods. And it says that when Moses got down the mountain, the tablets that were in his hand, he cast them down and broke them. And I
needed to kind of give you that running start because that brings us to where we are this morning in our 34th chapter. Because now as we consider chapter 34 and we now look at verse 1, we now find the reason why Moses was angry. We saw what the episode was at the foot of the mountain, but now Moses makes his way back up the mountain. And here it says in Exodus 34:1, it says, the Lord now says to Moses, I want you to cut for yourself two tablets of stone. And I'm going to write on the tablets the same way that I did on the first tablets, the one that you broke. And so God was saying to Moses, yeah, you let your anger get the best of you. And I've told you all before, you know, we got to be careful with our anger. And I've been doing this study on how to keep our anger in check over these past couple of months. And so if you have not, not this coming Wednesday, but next Wednesday, y'all come on out because we're going to talk about that. But again, here, Moses was so angry, God said, you get on back up the mountain. You need to go ahead and we need to redo this. And as God does that, he says there in that second verse, he says, be ready in the morning and come up in the morning to Mount Sinai and present yourself to me on the top of the mountain. So God is giving Moses instructions. He's saying, all right, I gave you the first tablets. You busted those up. We're going to redo. We're going to have a do-over. And I don't know about you, but I am so thankful that we serve a God that allows do-overs. He's a God that allows, for those of you who are golfers, mulligans. Mulligan is when you can take another shot at it. And so God is saying, I'm going to give you another shot at this. But you need to make your way up the mountain. You need to meet me in the morning, get on the top of the mountain, meet me on Mount Sinai, and we're gonna have a do-over. Mm-hmm. And thank God for the do-overs. Thank God that he allows us, even in the midst of our mess-ups, God can still use us, can still make some things happen, still bring some things to pass. And so as we see in verse 3, he says, now, not only do I want you on the mountain in the morning, I want you on the top of the mountain, but there are some conditions, there are some prerequisites. Make sure that no one comes up the mountain with you. Make sure that no one can be seen on all of the mountains. And not only do I not want any people on that mountain, I don't even want animals up there. Let no flocks, no herds graze opposite of that particular mountain. God wanted Moses just for himself. God had a job just for Moses. Nobody else needed to be involved with this because God was doing a special work. And God had destined and determined that Moses was the only somebody that he wanted at this juncture of God's purpose and God's plan. And see, God is very specific about what he wants, how he wants it, and when he wants it, and who he wants to do it. And so God was demonstrating this because God was saying to Moses, there shall be no compromise. And sometimes that's a little difficult for us to deal with, this issue of no compromise. God is the God of perfection. Don't misunderstand or misinterpret. It doesn't mean that we have to be perfect because we're not going to be perfect. None of us have the capacity to walk in our humanness and be perfect. But we are to strive daily, hourly, by the moment and by the second for perfection. We're to seek God out. And we're to walk according to his ways, his statutes, his precepts, and his heart's desire. And God was saying to Moses, I don't want anybody else involved in this. This is an A and B, a me and you. And in the light of that, nobody comes up this mountain. No animals, no persons. And I want this to be a deliberate, specific event so that now when you look at verse 4, God says, after Moses now has been given this charge, Moses now follows through and he cuts two tablets of stone like the first. He rose early in the morning and he went up on Mount Sinai as the Lord had commanded him, and he took in his hand two tablets of stone. Moses did exactly what God told him to do. He didn't say, well, you know what? These two tablets, maybe I can just get one big tablet and take that on up the mountain. Or maybe I can just get three or four of them and just, we can. God said two. Moses brought two. There is a benefit when we adhere to the word and the precepts of God. When God says a thing, I think it's okay for us to yield to a thing. When God says, this is the way I want it, we ought to be about the mindset to say, okay, God, if this is what you say, then I will yield myself to what your word, your will, and your purpose and plan for my life. I know that rubs against the grain for some of us. Because we kind of like Burger King, we want to have it our way. That's kind of the human condition. We like to do and have things the way we like to have and do them because we're used to doing it that way, but that's not God's way. God said to Moses, two tablets, bring them up the mountain on Mount Sinai and make sure that you have nobody else come with you. And that's why when you now look at verse 5, it says, once Moses did what he needed to do, then the Lord did what he was going to do. Moses had to make the ascension. He had to make his way up for the Lord to come down. In order for the meeting to happen, in order for God to reveal himself and for God to come down and to meet Moses, Moses had to make his way up the right way. Are you all hearing what I'm saying? We serve a God of order. We serve a God who does not operate in confusion. But he's the God that says there's a right way, a way that I've ordained, and a way that I have sanctioned. So the Lord, after Moses makes his ascent, it says the Lord descended in the cloud and stood with him there and proclaimed the name of the Lord. God met Moses only after Moses met God on God's terms. Not on Moses' terms, not on the people's terms, because if you remember, the people were out of order in the first place. But God said, I'm going to set the agenda. And when you meet me based upon my agenda, then I will meet you. And so now God descends in the cloud. And he now stays there, stood there with Moses. And God proclaimed the name of the Lord. And as it says there now in that sixth verse, it says, the Lord now passed before him and proclaimed, the Lord, a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. Here we have God, and we have him
moving in the midst of his interaction with Moses. We have God making the proclamation, the Lord, a God merciful and gracious. And what we're seeing here is that as God is giving this second chance, he is proclaiming the very nature of his character. In essence, God is saying that I am the Lord your God. I am the merciful God. I am the gracious God. And I am the God that is slow to anger. And I am abounding in steadfast love and in faithfulness. And I don't know about you, but somebody needs to hear that this morning. Somebody needs to know that our God is a merciful God, that he's a gracious God, and he's a God that even though we mess up every now and again, and some of us mess up a little more than now and again, but God is a God who is slow to anger, and he is abundant in steadfast love and faithfulness. Somebody ought to say amen for God's faithfulness. Amen for him being slow to anger. Because if God was like us, if God demonstrated our mentality, boy, some of us would be in trouble. Because some of us are not as slow to anger as we ought to be. Some of us are what I like to call quick-tempered at the drop of a hat. And the hat doesn't even have to drop fully. It could just be. It don't even have to hit the floor. And our anger starts to be displayed. But God is slow to anger. And he is the God who knows each of us. Why? Because he formed and fashioned. He knows us. Some of us wish that he didn't know us as well as he does. But he knows us because he formed and fashioned us. He knew us even before we came forth from the womb. Just like Jeremiah, God said, I knew you even before you were formed in the womb. And therefore, God knows us the same way. And because of that, we ought to be thankful that God is slow to anger. And that he is also merciful. You know the difference between mercy and grace? God's mercy is that he does not punish us for what we deserve. That's mercy. When God could punish us for what we deserve. And I'm not talking about how, you know, a lot of people say, well, I didn't do anything wrong. They done all kind of wrong. I didn't do anything wrong. And they're not even acknowledging the wrong that they've done. Well, see, God doesn't play that. God knows the wrong that we've done. And when we fess that up and say, God, I've messed up. God, forgive me. God, I realize I've gone the wrong way. I now want to get back in your grace. I repent of my wrongdoing. And God already knows it even before we say it. But it's a good thing when we fess up before God. The Bible tells us that when we confess our sins, God is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. And so this whole thing, God is merciful. When he could punish us, he steps back and says, no way, I don't want to do that. I love you. I don't want to do it. I will if I have to, but I'd rather not. That's his mercy. Now his grace is when God decides to give us a little extra goodness on top of what he's already given us. He's blessed us. He's provided for us. He has sustained us. He's given us so much. But you know what? God says, you know what? I just want to love on you a little bit more. I'm going to give you a little bit more. Instead of God saying, I'm going to give you this much. You know what? I'm just going to give you this much just because I'm God and just because I love you. And I don't know about you, but I'm glad that I serve a God who sees me in my fault. But God says, I love you. I'm not going to punish you the way I could. And you know what? I'm just going to love you even more. Maybe if I love on you a little more, you won't feel the need to mess up. Maybe if I love you just a little bit more, maybe you'll decide, you know what? It's not worth me going off course and off script with God. If I love you just a little more, maybe I would realize that my God is worthy and I don't need to operate outside the boundaries. If I just stay within the boundaries, everything is going to be all right. God's merciful and he is gracious. He is slow to anger and he is abounding. You know what abounding means? Means he never runs out. He never has to put in a back order for his steadfast love or his faithfulness. He doesn't have to call up the warehouse and ask them to send some more of his steadfast love or his faithfulness. Why? Because he is abounding. He never runs out of his love and his faithfulness. That's why he's an awesome God. That's why when we talk about what a mighty God we serve, that we ought to every moment of the day give thanks to God, because God could have done some things, but praise God that he allowed his grace, his mercy, and his steadfast love and faithfulness to find us. He goes on here in verse 7. In verse 7, this same God of the abounding and steadfast love, the same God who is slow to anger, the same God who is merciful and gracious, is the God who in verse 7, keeping steadfast love for thousands. Which means God, as I said a few moments ago, he doesn't run out. Which means if he's got some for you, he's got some for you. If he's got some for you, he's got some for me. If he's got some for us, that means there's other folk that God has a lot of steadfast love for, keeping his steadfast love for thousands, and he forgives iniquity. Anybody want to be forgiven this morning? Anybody thankful when God forgives us of our wrongdoing? Says he steadfast love for thousands, that means an unlimited number, and he forgives our iniquities, our transgressions, and our sins. That means everything that we have done wrong, thought wrong, spoken wrong, have planned to do wrong, God has forgiven all of it. Whether it's a transgression, whether it's a sin, no matter how you color it, God has forgiven it. And somebody ought to be glad that God in his grace and God in his mercy has forgiven everything. You know what? God has forgiven stuff I've forgotten. I don't know if you've ever take an inventory of your sin. If you thought back over the years of things that you've done, things that you've contemplated, things that you may have planned, maybe you didn't follow through with it, but you planned it. And then some things that you planned and you follow through with them. And then there were some things that you planned, you follow through with them, and it was so good you backed up and did it again. None of you all did that. I'm talking about some other folk. My sin, my iniquity, my transgression, all of it is the same thing. It's talking about everything that I've done that's been out of order with God, everything that has been in opposition to his word, and everything that smacks against the very character and nature of an all-loving, all-gracious, and all-holy God. Everything that I have done, God has forgiven. Thank you, Jesus. And then he goes on to say, but who will by no means clear the guilty? You know who the guilty are? Those who are unrepentant in their sin. That person
who just thinks I can just go ahead and sin and I can just go ahead and get away with it and I'm not hurting anybody and I'm just kind of doing my own thing and I'm not acknowledging that this is kind of how I'm rolling, I'm doing what I'm doing, it's not a big deal. And that person who thinks that, well, I'm going to go out here and do whatever I want to do and just kind of turn a blind eye and act as if it's not a big deal. That's the person that God says, by no means am I going to clear the guilty. You know what that says? That says I need to be checking myself. I need to be checking my own conscience. I need to be checking my own attitude, my own mentality, how I think, what I do, how I operate, how I engage with people. I need to be on blast with myself, checking myself. Because if I'm not doing that, I can slide into sin and not even be aware of it, and I can be doing it like it's no big deal. And God said, that's the person I will in no means clear the guilty. Right. And see, if there's any category that I never want to find myself in, I don't want to find myself in that guilty category. Let me be in the category of the steadfast love for thousands and God forgiving my sin, my transgressions, and my iniquity. But I don't want to be in that category where he says, by no means God is going to clear the guilty. Because note what happens. He says that person, God's going to visit the iniquity of the fathers and on the children and on the children's children to the third and fourth generation. What a wonderful God we serve, but he is also a jealous God. What a gracious and magnificent God that we serve, but he's a God who does not wink at, he does not sweep under the rug, and he does not take our sin lightly. He says, I'm the God that's going to deal with sin, and he does it out of his love for us. Because God does not want us to just back ourselves away from him to where we can't even get back to him. And unfortunately, we've seen that happen, where people have just gotten so caught up in their sin. They've moved further and further and further and further away from God so that when the voice of God comes to them, they're not even hearing it. They can't understand it, and therefore they don't respond to it. But God says that I am the God who will visit the iniquity of the fathers on the children and on the children's children to the third and the fourth generation. Now, let me caution you with this, too. But I say this as an encouragement. So much more the reason why we ought to walk in holiness before God. So much more the reason why we need to walk in righteousness. Because when we do that, we avoid that sin falling from one generation to the next generation, to the next generation, and to the fourth generation. We have the ability, and truthfully, we have the responsibility to set the tone so that the sin, the iniquity, the transgression does not fall to the next generations. And beloved, it's just a sad but true fact. We're seeing in our society today where sin is falling to the next generations. We're seeing generations of people who know not God. Generations of people who have not received Jesus Christ and have no desire to do so and don't see the necessity of why it's even something they need to consider. And so now we're seeing generations who don't know God. The next generation, if they don't know God, then they're not going to share God with the next generation. If that generation doesn't know Christ, they're not going to share it with the next generation. And so you have generations of people who are being born who are on their way to hell. And that's why he says, I don't want to hurt. I don't want to take people off. I don't want to do damage to anybody. I want to love on them. I want to be gracious unto them. I don't want anybody to perish. But if I have to, I will deal with the sin even to the next generations, to the third and the fourth generation. We have the ability, we have the capacity to stop our next generations from falling out of good grace with God. We have the capacity to bring that to pass. And that's why when you now look at this last verse, as I get ready to close this, that eighth verse says, Moses, after hearing all that God said, all of what God proclaimed in terms of him being gracious and merciful, and the God who was slow to anger, the God who wants to give love, and the God who is gracious and abundant in steadfast love, that God who is abundant in faithfulness. When Moses heard what God was saying, the first thing he did was he bowed his head to the earth and he worshiped God. And he worshiped God because he realized that that was the thing to do. There comes a time, beloved, when we come to the acknowledgement that God is who he is, that God is loving and gracious, that God is merciful and compassionate, that our God is the God who is slow to anger. He is the God who is abundant in steadfast love. He is merciful and gracious, and our response to him ought to always be, and not just on a Sunday morning at 10:15, but it ought to be every day of the week. It ought to be 24/7. We ought to bow down and worship God, because God is worthy of our worship and worthy of our praise. He is the God that we ought to bow down before as we acknowledge what an awesome God, what a great God, what a mighty God that we serve. If we take inventory and recognize how good God has been to us, how God has kept us, how he's watched over us, how he's provided for us, he continues to reside with us. He says, I'm never going to leave you. I will never forsake you. Lo, I'm going to be with you always, even through your difficult seasons, through your day seasons and your night seasons, through the times when things are well and the times when things are not well. I'm the God who makes sure that everything works out the way that I've intended for it to work out. And I'm the God who always raises my hedge of protection around you. And I am the God who will always provide for you in the midst of your need, because I am the God of your abundant supply. Not that you will supply it, but I will be the God who will supply your need according not to your ability, but according to my riches and glory. What a mighty God we serve. That God that says, I love you even though you messed up. I love you even though you're planning to mess up. I still love you even though you're looking to mess up in the future. I'm going to erase away your sin, because I'm the God that loves you even in the midst of your iniquity now. I'm not going to forget it. I'm not going to just kick it to the side, but I'm going to give you every opportunity to repent and to come back into right relationship. And if you come up the mountain and meet me, I will come down and meet you in the clouds. Because I am the God that's willing to meet you. And I'm the God who wants to have relationship with you. So no matter where you are, no matter what you've done, God says, I am a mighty God who loves you and who's demonstrated that by giving you my son, Christ Jesus. And all you have to do is to believe in him, because no man gets to the Father but through the Son. What a mighty God. Mighty God that we serve. Come on and stand to your feet if you would. Our God who loves us with an undying love. The Bible says he loves us with an everlasting love. That love that covers our sins, that love that strengthens us when we're weak, that love that enables us to walk worthy of what God has called us to day in and day out. Merciful and gracious is our God. Mighty and majestic is he. And today, if you would love to have a relationship with that God that is slow to anger, that God who is gracious and merciful, the God who has steadfast love and forgiveness for you and for me. Today is the day, this is the hour for you to come and receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Everything that we do it for this moment so that you can come to give your life to Christ. Don't put off till tomorrow or next week or some other time, because this is the moment. For For those of you in the house, for those of you worshiping with us online, if you want to receive Jesus Christ, all it takes is a prayer. Just recognize that you are a sinner. And recognize that Jesus Christ died on the cross. God's Son, He did it for you, and He did it for me. We're going to go into prayer right now. Please bow. And if you want to receive Jesus Christ, and you can whisper this prayer, trust Him with all your heart and receive Him as Lord and Savior. Heavenly Father, we come today and we thank You. We bless You and we praise You. Lord, we acknowledge Your love for us, Your grace, Your mercy, Your compassion, Your kindness. Thank You that You demonstrated it through giving us Your Son, Christ Jesus. And Father, I believe in Your Son, Christ Jesus. I believe that He died on Calvary's cross. He shed His precious blood for all of our sins. And Lord, more personally, He did it for my sins. As He went into the grave, on that third day, He rose. And He did so with all power in His hands. He rose with salvation power. He rose with life-changing power. And so, Father, I thank You and I trust that just as Jesus rose from the grave with all power, I too can rise from my grave of sin and shame. Not in and of myself, but because of my trust in Christ Jesus and the work that He did at Calvary. So, Lord, I'm thanking You right now in advance for my salvation. Lord, I know that because of Your love for me and because of the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, I now am a new creature. Paul says, I'm a new creation in Christ Jesus. And now I have been brought into a family of believers. I'm no longer out here by myself, but now I have a new family in Christ. And because of that, Lord, now I can grow in my faith. I can walk in new ways. And because of that, You've given other people who can be a help to me, be an aid to me. And Lord, I can be an aid to them. And so, Lord, we grow together in this. And I thank You for the opportunity to mature in my faith. Father, thank You for Your Holy Spirit who encourages me, who guides me, gives me wisdom and direction, who helps me to grow closer to You and closer to my brothers and sisters. So, Father, right now, have Your way in my life. I yield and I turn my life over to You. No longer am I trying to run my life by my own standards, but, Lord, it's by Your word, Your will, and Your way. For that, Father, I thank You. And, Lord, right now, for those who have already given their lives to Christ, those who have already received You as Lord and Savior, but Lord, they just need some help. They just need some strength. They need a little encouragement right now. Lord, they're going through a difficult time, and Lord, they just need to hold to Your unchanging hand. So Father, bless them right now. Strengthen them in the midst of their circumstances. And oh God, let them know that You're the God who is right there with them. You're the God who is always available. You're the God who is always willing to love on them and strengthen them in the midst of their circumstances. So Father, right now we thank You, we bless You, we praise You, and we ask right now that You would minister to Your people, whether they're a new saint or a seasoned saint. Just let them know that You are the God who is right there with them and right there for them. And for these things, Father, we truly give You our thanks. Lord, we thank You, we love You, and we praise You. And we offer this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Go on and give God some praise this morning. What a mighty God we serve. As we prepare to leave this place this morning, remember to be prayerful for those who are not able to come out to worship, for those who have lost loved ones over the week. Remember to continue to pray for our veterans and for all of what they have sacrificed for our freedom. And remember this week to make sure that you cast your vote for your candidate. now, may the love of God, the grace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ, and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide with us both henceforth now and forevermore. The children of an all-gracious and all-loving God said amen and amen. And God bless you, and thank you so much for joining us here at Spirit of New Ministries. We'll see you next time. If I can ask you to just remain seated for just a moment, all of the members of Spirit of New, if you can just kind of be seated for just a moment. We have a couple of bits of information we want to bring to your attention.